Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to talk to you again about my experience with Artisan and Artiflex lenses in children. And I shared some of this data last year with you, and some of it is much the same, except I've done many more children and I have more longer term follow-up. I have no financial interest in any of the subject matter that I'm going to discuss. And I suppose the first thing to do is to acknowledge Jan Wurst, who in 1997 introduced these implants, and initially was thought that they were not going to be any way successful, but how wrong everybody has been proven, and many years later, these have been a huge a benefit both to adults and no more particularly in pediatric eye surgery. As you know, the disadvantages of aphakic spectacles are the reduced field, the prismatic effect, the jack-in-a-box effect, the heaviness, and in unilateral cases, anisocoria. And contact lenses in children are equally difficult with the number that children go through every year, the risk of infection, the non-compliance rate, particularly in unilateral cataracts, is very high. Having said that, bilateral specs in children work very well, even though there's all these side effects, which are much more seen when we use them in adult cataract surgery. But in children, aphakic spectacles work very well. But this is a useful alternative when the child gets older and when the parents want to take them out of spectacles and when they're intolerant of contact lenses. So the indications are aphakic patients with inadequate capsule support, particularly if there's no way you cannot put the IOL into the sulcus. Children with lensectomy for ectopia lentis, and that's a very big indication in my practice, children with Marfan syndrome. And there are people who nowadays try and preserve some of the capsule, and they do all sorts of acrobatics in terms of trying to keep, put a capsular implant into the eye. I must say, I've not ever shared this too much, and many of the children I see, it wouldn't be possible to do so. And one would worry anyway later on that these implants would be highly unstable in these children. And again, the third indication, of course, is trauma. Children left aphakic due to trauma. Another useful group of children, and this is a really good group, is the, in particular the aphakic patients, children with high anisometropia, intolerant to contact lenses, children post-congenital cataract extraction with posterior chamber IOLs who have had I've had a surprise, and many of the children that we implant at birth, anybody who in the audience who is doing lots of congenital cataracts will know that many of these children become quite highly myopic later on in life, in spite of all the formula and the calculations that we use to implant these children at birth. And the other useful group of children, although this is not as good as the others, is children with retinopathy of prematurity, because many of these children go very myopic and they become anisometropic. Now, they're the only group, though, that one has issues with, because of many of these children have a shallow anterior chamber because of reduced growth of the anterior segment of the eye. And another useful group is the children with bilateral high emmetropia, those with the comorbid disorders, behavioral disorders, or learning disability, and obviously children with high astigmatism. And these implants have been used in small numbers for some time. If you look at 2001, there was one eye put in, and one and two, and the biggest single group was 20 in 2008 for the group I just spoke to, children with neurobehavioral disorders. But so in total, between 2001 and 2010, they only had a total of 31 implants inserted, which is a very, very small number. This is one of the studies in 2001 with high anisometropia, bilateral high ametropia, and neurobehavioral disorders. We've done a number of, obviously we put many of these in now. Many years ago, I implanted pediatric children unilateral cataracts, and my longest one now is about 23 years. So obviously I have children who've gone myopic since. I've also done a number of children, if ectopia lentis is a big part of the practice, and this is the group that I've implanted Artisan iris claw lenses in for correction of aphakia, some soon after the surgery and some years later, because many of them end up initially tolerant of contact lenses and aphakic spectacles, so there's no rush in many of them to do this. But when they get a lot older, then this is when the parents and the child look for something different. And this is a whole group, and this was published in the British Journal of Ophthalmology. We've done many, many more since. And these are children with excellent outcomes. Easy to do. If you do a lot of adult implants, then the pediatrics is obviously much easier. I've never understood, if you talk to pediatricians, many of them don't do very much surgery. I mean, a big volume practice in some pediatric centers would be 20 congenital cataracts, and many of them don't do any adult cataract surgery. And of course, this is a huge disadvantage. If you think of all the phaco technology that's come on board that has markedly improved the outcomes of pediatric cataract surgery. I can understand why in some cases pediatric surgeons doing this procedure might have some more difficulty, because these eyes are aphakic. They're probably really difficult to inclavate because of the lack of iris support, because many of them would have had a vitrectomy done. But if you do a lot of adults, then it's not so much a problem. This is another paper published in the ACTA in 2012, where we use foldable iris fixated intraocular implants in a group of children. And these are all the children with the high behavioral disorder, high myopia, children post-retinopathy of prematurity, children with significant neurobehavioral disorders. And for years and years, these group of children have remained blind, because you can't give them glasses, they just wouldn't work for them. And obviously you can't fit them with contact lenses. So these children have lived in a cocoon of blindness for years and years with significant neurobehavioral disorders and a world that's very dark. And this group of children, ironically, have been the biggest single beneficiaries of this type of implant. We did a study where we used the VEQ, the quality, using the National Eye Institute Visual Functioning Questionnaire in a whole group of these children. And we looked at all these parameters, and lo and behold, the results of this are striking. On every single issue, they improve, and their quality of life is immeasurably better. And what is even more striking is the parents come and tell you that there's been an enormous benefit to the child. So this group of children benefits significantly from these implants. And this is what the American study with a smaller number of children found before we did ours, the same thing. So there's a statistically significant improvement in corrected visual acuity. Quality of life issues become dramatically better. And any of these children, ironically, to date, I haven't seen any serious, in fact, I've seen no eye complications. So this is a really beneficial group of children from these Artiflex IOLs. What have we seen? We've seen some initial transient raised intraocular pressure. We've seen some deposition on the implant. In children, I've seen no dislocation to date. Obviously, we've seen a number of adults with dislocation, but not in children. But the biggest single area that people home in on is endothelial cell loss. And in particular, these are a young group of patients. What's going to happen in 10 years, 15 years? And particularly because of the experience of angle-supported IOLs. And as you know, there are the French group who are not the biggest supporters of Artiflex and Artisan IOLs. And they now talk about these patients, adults, losing endothelial cells at 6-7 years. Obviously, we've all been worried by when we see something like this appearing. And I've now got probably Artisans in for 12 years, 14 years, 13. I've Artiflex in for maybe 7. I've only had one patient in one of their eyes where I've seen endothelial cell loss, where I've had to explant the implant. I have seen, and obviously we're watching these extremely closely. So in treatment, in children anyway, there's a huge advantage, because you have the treatment range of high myopia and hyperopia. The other great feature, I think, of these is that they're reversible. You can take them out. You can also do laser on top of the cornea in older children with these, so they we call bioptics. And the single biggest factor which you want is they give very quick visual rehabilitation. And this is particularly useful in younger children, where you want to go back patching, you want to do it very quickly. And I mean, if you remember years ago when we started doing the epicarytoplasty in children, and of course the rehabilitation time was months, and that's why it, for a whole lot of other reasons as well, it fell out of favor. And of course the advantage here is there's no special operating room requirements. It can be done by non-refractive surgeons and they're far less expensive. The potential disadvantage is obviously many of these children anyway will have had there'll be aphakic or pseudophakic. In ROP, the problem is shallow anterior chamber, which excludes a number of these children, which would ironically get huge advantage out of it, but because of the shallow chamber, they're not suitable. And of course, the potential other issue is because children rub their eyes a lot, that they'll dislocate the implants. I haven't seen that to date. So when it comes to pediatric refractive surgery, laser vision correction or phakic IOLs, I've done both of them and I continue to do both of them, and phakic IOLs win out every time, I think, in the short term anyway. And this is just such a child with implants inserted. This is another child, one of my longest, is not pseudophakic, a congenital cataract at birth, then went about minus 10, minus 9, minus 10 myopic, has now got an anterior chamber iris fixated IOL with an excellent visual outcome. So indications then, severe anisometropia, those children intolerant of spectacles and contact lenses, high magnitude anisometropia, children with neurobehavioral disorders, pseudophakic eyes, and of course the other one, which is accommodative strabismus in older children, children who will never get out of their glasses, where their refractive power is too high for laser refractive surgery, it's above plus 4. And in a small number of these children, accommodative phakic artisan IOLs will be very useful to fix their accommodative strabismus. So major advantages, I think, if all of them, is the quick visual rehabilitation. What are the future issues? Well, as I said, endothelial cell count remains the single biggest issue. It's for pediatric ophthalmologists, it's the single thing they'll ask you about, and they home in on this. Endothelial cell count, these are young people, what's going to happen to them? And of course, as is possible in time, they will lose cells. And but we now have, we're not totally stuck because we can, with the improvement in corneal refractive surgery, with corneal, with DSEC and things, a lot of these problems will be solved probably. Adult experience, in my adult experience, I'm not seeing endothelial cell loss, in contrast to what the fringe group have been talking about. And so therefore, what is the option in children who are aphakic, if the choice is between an artisan IOL and indeed a slail fixated implant, an artisan IOL wins out every day. Thank you very much.